Today, my topic of presentation is obese patient for laparoscopic surgery. So I will be dealing with the obesity problems and preoperative part. The intraoperative and postoperative part will be covered by Dr. Suruchi. First of all, why this topic is so much important for us? First of all, the obesity is now a global epidemic. So it increases with the increasing the incidence, the number of obese patient presented for emergency and elective surgery is also increasing. They have a different set of problems and they usually present with multiple comorbidities and having a higher risk of perioperative complication and increased mortality. So WHO classify obesity on the basis of BMI. The patients who are having a BMI of more than 30 kilogram per meter square are called obese patients, and they categorize the obesity in three classes, class 1, 2, and 3. In class 1, the BMI is 30 to 35. In class 2, the BMI is 35 to 40. And in class 3, the BMI is more than 40 kilogram per meter square. So it is also called as the Quetelet Index. So now coming to our case is a 40-year-old female with body weight of 116 kgs and height of 160 centimeters. The body mass index calculated is 45.3 kilogram per meter square. She presented to us with the problem of epigastric pain for last 2 months, and on evaluation by ultrasonography, she was found to have multiple gallstones, and she is posted for laparoscopic cholecystectomy in the next week. And she is also having history of snoring and daytime somnolence on evaluation. So the BMI of our patient is 45.3. So she is coming in the category of class 3 obesity, which is previously also called as morbid obesity. In medical literature, the few terms are also there, like super obese, super obese, and hyper obese, with a BMI of 50 to 60, 60 to 70, and more than 70 kilogram per meter square. So it is very, but these terms are obsolete now in the current literature. So the BMI is very, advantage of BMI is that it is very easy to calculate. But there are few disadvantages of BMI also. First, it cannot discriminate between the adipose and the non-adipose tissue. Here we can understand it with this example. We have two patients. With the one patient, both the patient is having same BMI, but the one patient one is very tall and muscular man, and the patient two is a short height, obese man. So, but the BMI of both the patient are same. So it cannot discriminate between the adipose tissue and non-adipose tissue in any individual. It also cannot tell us about the distribution of fat. So why this distribution of fat is important, how the distribution of fat is different in an obese individual. So not all the fat within the body is identical. Unlike peripherally distributed fat, here you can see, the fat is outside the body cavity. The intraperitoneal fat, which is also called as the visceral fat, is highly metabolically active, and it is known to be a contributor to several diseases. These patients are more likely to exhibit the metabolic syndrome, which consists of central obesity, hypertension, insulin resistance, and hypercholesterolemia. On the basis of distribution of fat, these patients, the shape of the body of obese individual can be categorized either as an apple-shaped or the pear-shaped. The people who exhibit central or visceral obesity are often male and can be described as apple-shaped, while those with the predominantly peripherally fat distribution are more likely to be female and are described as pear-shaped. So in patients with central obesity, most of the weight is lies above the waist, and they are more likely to have difficult airway, ventilation problem, greater risk of cardiovascular diseases, thrombosis, and increased risk of metabolic syndrome. On the other hand, the patient with peripheral obesity, mostly have less comorbidities and less perioperative, less risk of perioperative cardiopulmonary complications. WHO describes central obesity as waist circumference more than 88 centimeters in women and more than 102 centimeters in men, or the weight to height, waist to height ratio greater than 0.55. Now, coming to our patient, how will we go for the pre-anesthetic checkup and what are the associated diseases linked to obesity in these patients? So careful history should be taken to confirm or rule out the comorbidities in obese patients. We should give extra attention to the history of obstructive sleep apnea, which includes snoring, frequent interruption in breathing during sleep as reported by others, nocturnal choking, excessive daytime sleepiness, waking up unrefreshed, and morning headache. The sleeping habits should also be asked. So we have to ask whether the patient is able to lie flat or tolerate supine position. That may reveal profound oxygen desaturation, airway obstruction, and respiratory insufficiency. The dietary habits should also be looked for. Whether the patient is on any weight reducing diet, because that may lead to nutritional deficiency. So as in bariatric surgery, it is routine to initiate a preoperative liver shrinking diet to reduce the size of the liver and make access to the stomach technically easier. So there is also evidence that 2 to 6 weeks of intense preoperative dieting can improve respiratory function, glucose tolerance, and facilitate laparoscopic surgery, and may be worth considering in high risk patients. Coming to the respiratory system changes. Obese patients, the functional residual capacity is decreased. There is significant atelectasis and shunting in the depending lung regions also. Along with that, because to supply the increased body mass, the resting metabolic rate. On cessation of breathing. So which can be minimized by or delayed by pre-oxygenation, induction of anesthesia in semi-upright position with application of CPAP or high flow nasal oxygen and avoidance of prolonged apnea. Wheeze is also a common finding in obese patient, and this is mainly due to the small airway closure rather than asthma. The small airway closure occurs mainly because the increased amount of fat inside the chest and outside the chest wall and also in the abdomen. And because of the excess amount of fat, there is a chronic pro-inflammatory condition exhibit that will also lead to small airway closure and wheeze. So bronchodilator therapy may be useful in differentiating these two conditions. And it has been seen that 50% of the patient diagnosed with asthma recover with weight loss. Sleep disordered breathing is a spectrum of condition ranging from obstructive sleep apnea to through obesity hypoventilation syndrome. It is mainly due to the deposition of fat in the lateral pharyngeal wall. And its severity depends on the number of episodes and the severity of oxygen desaturation occurring every hour. So severe OSA occurs in 10 to 20% of the patients with BMI more than 35 kilograms per meter square and is often undiagnosed. If untreated, it may progress to obstructive sleep apnea. So if untreated, it will progress to obesity hypoventilation syndrome, which is a triad of obesity with BMI of more than 35 kilogram per meter square, sleep disordered breathing with the hypoxemia, and daytime hypercapnia with a PaCO2 of more than 45 mmHg. So there is a difference between the OSA and obesity hypoventilation syndrome. In OSA, patient breathes normally when they are awake. They do not retain the CO2. But in OHS, the patient are hypercapnic at rest as well as in the awake state. So they are hypercapnic during awake state also. So because of this chronic hypercapnia, they may develop pulmonary hypertension, right ventricular hypertrophy, and failure. OSA, the diagnosis of OSA doubles the incidence of the importance of OSA, basically, because if patient is having OSA, it doubles the incidence of postoperative desaturation, respiratory failure, postoperative cardiac event, and ICU admission. The severity of OSA is also associated with the increased sensitivity of opioid-induced respiratory depression. And there are high chances of having other sequelae also in obese patients with OSA, like hypertension, LVH, RVH, and pulmonary hypertension. And it is also associated with a difficult airway and laryngoscopy. So if this condition is identified preoperatively and treated adequately with the help of CPAP or BiPAP therapy, the chances or the risk of perioperative complication can be much reduced. So how will you diagnose the OSA? So first of all, the history. As we have discussed earlier, the patient will have the history of habitual snoring, interrupted nocturnal breathing during sleep as reported by the others, excessive daytime sleepiness, arterial hypertension, nocturnal choking, waking unrefreshed, and morning headaches. So our patient is also having a history of snoring and daytime somnolence. So when this patient comes to us to the PAC, then we should go for the stop bank questionnaire, which is a most sensitive screening tool to identify patient with OSM. But the definitive diagnosis is made based on the polysomnography and overnight oximetry testing. So the stop bank questionnaire consists of total 8 points. The upper 4 points are being asked to the patient in the form of questions during the PAC time. So these are S's for the snore. So we need to ask to the patient that, do you snore loudly, loud enough to be heard through the closed doors? Tired, do you, T is for tired, do you feel tired, fatigue, or sleepy during daytime? O is for observed, has anyone observed you stop breathing during your sleep? P is for pressure, do you have or are you being treated for high blood pressure? Other than that, the 4 other points are BMI more than 35 kilogram per meter square, age more than 50 years, neck circumference that we need to measure is more than 40 centimeters, and gender male. So if the score is low risk, if the score is 0 to 2, then these patients comes in the category of low risk for OSA. But if the score is more than 3, it implies significant risk of OSA or intermediate risk of OSA. Score of more than 6 implies very high likelihood of OSA, and they must go for the sleep studies. And it has a direct correlation with the postoperative desaturation and respiratory problem. So how will you screen the obese patient for sleep disordered breathing? So if the status of OSA is unknown, we have to go for the stop bank score to categorize them for the risk stratification. So if the score is 0 to 2 and ASA status is 1 to 2, then they are considered at low risk patients. If the score is 0 to 2 but the ASA status is more than 2, then these patients should go for the preoperative assistant assessment by an specialist. If the stop bank score is 3 to 5, then also they should go for the preoperative assessment by a specialist. The specialist could be a anesthetist, a sleep physician, or a bariatric physician. So on assessment, what we need to assess? We need to see the anatomical features suggestive of difficult airway, like MPG 3 or 4, or neck circumference more than 50 centimeters. And we also need to see the SpO2 less than 94% on the room air, if it is, and serum bicarbonate is more than 28 millimoles per liter. So if these things are present, then these patients are also come in the high risk category. if these things are not present and patient is having NYHA grade 3 for exertional dyspnea, then also these patients comes in the category of high risk. If NYHA is less than grade 3, means patient is having not much exertional dyspnea, then they will go for they will come in the category of moderate risk. So all the high risk patients should go for the sleep study. Now what we will see in the sleep study or polysomnography, we will see the apnea hypopnea index. So this is a index of total number of complete cessation means apnea, and partial obstruction means hypopnea or breathing occurring per hour of sleep. So it is calculated by this simple formula, which is number of apnea plus hypopnea events divided by number of hours of sleep. So apnea means complete cessation of airflow for at least 10 seconds. And hypopnea means at least 50% reduction in ventilation compared to baseline for at least 10 seconds. So it tells us about the, it assesses the severity of OSA. So on the basis of AHI, the severity OSA can be categorized in mild, moderate, and severe grades. And here, when the AHI is 5 to 14 per hour, it comes in the mild grade of OSA. When the AHI is 15 to 30 per hour, it comes in the moderate grade of OSA. When the AHI is more than 30 per hour, then it comes in the category of severe OSA. Now, what could be our management, perioperative management of this OSA, for this OSA in obese patients? So if the OSA status is unknown, so we have to stratify the risk according to the previous slide that we have discussed. So on risk assessment, if the patient is in the low risk category with easy airway, then they can be managed in the ward in the postoperative period. If the patient is in the low risk category, but airway is difficult, then they can be managed with a low opioid strategy and overnight SpO2 monitoring. If the patient is in the moderate category, then also they can be managed with a low opioid therapy and overnight oximetry. If the patient is come in the high risk category, then they must go for the sleep study and we have to see the results. So if the patient in the, according to the sleep study, is in the mild or moderate OSA category, then we can go for low opioid and overnight SpO2 monitoring, but if possible, CPAP should be started before surgery. But if the patient is in the significant or severe OSA category, then CPAP therapy must be started and we have to see the compliance and benefit in the symptoms. So if a patient is compliant to the CPAP therapy or there is benefit in the symptom, then they can also be managed with a low opioid and overnight SpO2 monitoring in the postoperative period. But if it is not there, then the invasive monitoring as due care will be required in these patients. Non-OSA patients who are unable to tolerate CPAP therapy should also undergo sleep study. So patients with undiagnosed OSA or those unable to tolerate CPAP are at highest risk. Patients fully compliant with CPAP therapy, usually which is indicated by the symptomatic relief, are at lower risk of perioperative event. Use of CPAP or BiPAP for those who are affected, if possible, should be commenced in the preoperative period, as 6 weeks of successful CPAP therapy are likely to reduce the perioperative risk. Coming to the airway evaluation, the obesity increases the 30% chances of difficult airway and difficult intubation and ventilation. It has been seen that BMI more than 50 kg per meter square is an independent predictor of both difficult intubation and face mask ventilation, with Mallampati score and neck circumference further useful indicator for difficult intubation and mask ventilation. Mallampati score of more than 3 and neck circumference of more than 40 centimeters increases the risk of difficult mask ventilation and intubation. If the neck circumference is more than 50 centimeter, the 20% increase of difficult laryngoscopy, and if it is more than 60 centimeters, there are 35% probability of difficult laryngoscopy. The bag and mask ventilation is also difficult in obese patients. The patient who are having beard, not having teeth, having a history of snoring, further increases the risk of ventilation, difficult ventilation. So if the patient is having beard, if possible, all the facial hair should be removed. If not, because of any obvious reason, then the beard clipping should be done. At least it can be useful. The front of neck access may also be more difficult in obese patients. We can use ultrasonography to identify the depth of cricothyroid membrane, and we can also mark the cricothyroid membrane in case of emergency situations. But that we have to do beforehand, before commencing our anesthesia. Previous anesthesia charge should be checked for any evidence of airway problems if patient is undergone any surgery beforehand. Coming to the cardiovascular system, the ischemic heart disease, hypertension, and cardiac failure are the most common occurrence with the obesity. With increasing volume, with increasing amount of body tissue, the total blood volume, cardiac output, and workload on the heart is increased. The left ventricle over the time develops an eccentric hypertrophy. Left atrium also enlarges due to the increased amount of blood volume and venous return. The coronary, they may also have a coronary artery disease due to the accelerated atherosclerosis. And untreated OSA may have associated pulmonary hypertension and right heart failure. There is also increased incidence of arrhythmia, secondary to SA node dysfunction, increased catecholamine, and fatty infiltration of the conducting system. There is also that will result in increase in the risk of atrial fibrillation and sudden cardiac death. And there is also increased risk of prolonged QT interval with increasing BMI, and therefore potential increased risk with the drugs such as ondansetron. Cardiomyopathy in obese patient is a direct effect of obesity on the heart. It mainly occurs due to the fatty infiltration and accumulation of triglyceride in cardiac myocytes that will lead to pressure-induced myocyte degeneration and cell dysfunction. Other than that, adipose cells also secrete locally active molecules like adipokines, which indirectly damage adjacent myocytes. In addition to that, the cardiac output, blood volume is increased. That will lead to ventricular dilatation and subsequently hypertrophy of the LV, which can lead to diastolic dysfunction. Means the ventricle will be, there will be failure to relax properly. If the wall thickening fails to keep pace with the chamber dilatation, the systolic hypertension can also occur. Means the LV, there is failure to contract the LV properly. So this disorder is called the obesity cardiomyopathy because it can occur in the absence of systemic hypertension and underlying organic heart disease. And it is associated with the progressive congestive heart failure and sudden cardiac death. So this is the reason why preoperative echocardiography is indicated in morbidly obese patients. A careful history and examination may reveal the signs and symptoms of cardiac disease. Specific cardiac investigation should be based on degree of exercise tolerance, presence of additional comorbidities, and site and extent of anticipated surgery. We should also see the ability to achieve 4 minutes, which indicates fitness and low risk patient. The breath holding time help in assessing the combined cardiopulmonary reserve. Despite their weight, morbidly obese patients may have a very poor nutritional status. The diabetes mellitus, the incidence of diabetes mellitus is very high in obese patients, and they should be assessed for the adequacy of glucose control and also for the presence of complications of diabetes. We need to optimize the glucose with referral to endocrinologist, and we should avoid delaying surgery based on HbA1c concentration only. Metabolic syndrome, we have already discussed. Coming to the investigation, the complete blood count, which is being a polycythemia, has to be looked for because of the chronic hypoxemia. The serum electrolyte, renal function, liver function test, blood glucose, ECG, X-ray, and SpO2 form the basic set of investigation. On the ECG, we can find the low voltage complexes, LV hypertrophy with or without strain, prolonged QT interval, right axis deviation or right bundle branch block, P pulmonary arrhythmia, and any sign suggestive of ischemic heart disease. Exercise tolerance should be assessed in these patients. The patients who are not able to exercise sufficiently, they can go for the pharmacological stress test. PFT may show the restrictive lung disease. Doppler ultrasound may be helpful to rule out a DVT in patients who are at high risk for venous thromboembolism, and sleep study should be done in all these patients accordingly. On echocardiography, we can estimate the systolic, diastolic function, chamber dimension, and pulmonary hypertension. The good images may be difficult to obtain by the transthoracic technique. So transesophageal echocardiography may be required in these patients for echo. The chest x-ray may show the evidence of cardiac failure and also assess the cardio thoracic ratio. Now, in which patient we should go for the arterial blood gas analysis? There are the few patients which may have a significant underlying respiratory disease that could be indicated by following features. And in these patients, we should consider the AVG analysis. The features that suggestive of significant underlying respiratory disease are the arterial saturation means SpO2 less than 95% on room air. If the forced vital capacity is less than 3 liter, or forced expiratory volume in 1 second is less than 1.5 liter, a patient is having respiratory wheeze at rest, or the serum bicarbonate concentration is more than 27 millimoles per liter, then we should go for the ABG. And we need to see what we will see. We will see the PCO2. PaCO2 on the AVG. If it is more than 45 mmHg, it indicates a degree of respiratory failure and likelihood of increased anesthetic risk. So on preoperative evaluation, if the patient is having poor functional capacity, abnormal ECG, uncontrolled blood pressure, congestive heart failure, or ischemic heart disease, SpO2 less than 94% on room air, bicarbonate is more than 27, previous DVT or pulmonary embolism, stop bang score of more than 5, OS MRS is more than 3, metabolic syndrome, or high NSQIP ACS risk, then these patients should be considered for preoperative CPAP therapy, blood gas, sleep study, echocardiogram, cardiopulmonary referral, and these patients should be managed by an experienced anesthetist, and we should also book a SDO bed for these patients. But if these red flag signs are not present, then these patients may go for the daycare surgery. Coming to the pre-medication, because of the increased risk of respiratory depression and desaturation, the sedative pre-medication should be avoided in these patients. These patients are prone for aspiration, so the prophylaxis can be given in the form of H2 antagonist and proton pump inhibitor. And preemptive analgesia with paracetamol and NSAID can be considered. Obesity itself is a risk factor for thromboembolism. So all patients must be considered for mechanical and pharmacological thromboprophylaxis. Early mobilization is recommended in the postoperative period. The mainstay of venous thromboembolism prophylaxis in obesity is pharmacological. Preoperative low molecular weight heparin may be indicated in high-risk patient and is recommended postoperatively in all the cases. So what are the high-risk patient in which we can consider the preoperative thrombopharmacological prophylaxis? So the criteria is prolonged immobilization. If the patient is on prolonged immobilization, total theater time of more than 90 minutes, age more than 60 years, BMI more than 30 kilogram per meter square, patient is having cancer, dehydration, or family history of venous thromboembolism. Then in these patients, the thromboembolism prophylaxis should be started before surgery. The patient who are at high risk but unable to tolerate heparin, temporary IVC filter can be considered in these patients. This is a dosing schedule of thromboprophylaxis, which is given according to the weight of the patient. Enoxaparin, deltaparin, and tinjaparin can be used. So enoxaparin that we are commonly used, the dose in a 50 to 100 kg obese patient, 50 to 100 kg patient is 40 milligram, 100 to 50, 100 to 150 kg, it is 40 milligram twice daily, and in more than 150 kg patient, it is 60 milligram twice daily. So a hypercoagulable state may extend beyond 2 weeks. So low molecular weight heparin should be continued for around 10 days postoperatively in all the patient undergoing any major surgery. So this is the obesity surgery mortality risk stratification score. It predicts the risk of mortality in obese patients. It has total 5 risk factors, which is BMI more than 50, male gender, age more than 45, hypertension, and risk of pulmonary hypoembolism. Each risk factor having a score of 1. If the score is 4 to 5, then there is a the highest risk of mortality, and which is 2.4 to 3%. And these patients should be observed in the postoperative period. These patients should be observed in the postoperative period. So the key points in the preoperative planning are: we should record the body mass index, total body weight, ideal body weight, and adjustable body weight on the PAC form. If central obesity is present, then we should look for the metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome, which is consist of visceral obesity plus diabetes, dyslipidemia, and hypertension, and these patients are at high risk. The cardiopulmonary involvement is very common in these obese patients. So we should look for the atrial fibrillation, QT prolongation, heart failure, pulmonary hypertension, or cardiomyopathy. It has been seen that 10% preoperative body weight reduction is an important. If visceral obesity is present, it will improve the respiratory function and laparoscopic surgical assess. So if the patient stop bank score is more than or equals to 5, or obesity hypoventilation syndrome is present, then they can be considered for regional or opioid free anesthesia, and postoperative CPAP therapy should be considered in these patients. Thank you.